Thank you, Chairman. And I must express my pleasure and disappointment. Pleasure, the introduction. Disappointment, you didn't have me walk on the tassel. Also, clearly from the last video, I am glad that there are so many women in the audience, so they will actually listen until the end. If I can have my guiding points, please. Now, what I'm going to talk today about is about robots and robotics. I know men are endangered, as we just heard, but we may be in a bit more danger, men and women, from machines. Now, the question I want to pose first is, can we have a robot that actually plays a tabla? And the tabla would be these two drums here, used in Hindustani music, Bollywood music, etc. Now, why would we want to do that? The tabla probably is the most complex drum in the world. To become an expert at the tabla takes at least 7 years, 7 years of continuous practice. What makes the situation even worse is that the way it's taught is still how it was taught hundreds of years ago. A guru and a chela, or a master and an apprentice as such. So even though now you have large classes to become, you know, expert at any level really, the guru or the master needs to spend time with you personally. It's very time intensive. The result of that is that there are very few skilled players around, and in this part of the world, even less. So there is a need to have some sort of rhythm machine that plays Indian rhythms to assist in training minimally and also possibly in performances. Now, years ago, to fulfill this need, there's a machine that was devised called a tal mala. A tal mala really produces Indian rhythms, but they do so electronically, producing the sounds of the drum itself. But when you listen to it, you can tell right away that it is not a real drum. It's like you listen to rhythms on a synthesizer. You know it is not a real trap set. You know it is artificial. So to have that feeling of full music is something that touches your heart. That's what it is about. So you need something that really simulates a real drum. So when we started research, we said, look, why try to produce a sound, you know? Why not try to simulate the process that produces a sound? It's going to be easier. Now, when we look at the human process that produces a sound, the hand, the fingers, and tablets played with the fingers, we decided design a biomimicking robot, a robot that simulates human motions. And this might be a semi-biomimicking robot. The fingers are a bit, you know, not quite as human beings, but it follows general principles of biomimicking. So we started that process. Now, we said in such a design, the first and foremost thing must be, it must sound real. The sound must be full. It must touch you, you must feel, aha, I'm listening to somebody playing, not a machine playing. So we started the design. We did some initial testing, and what we use advanced software to analyze the sounds produced by the robot and sounds produced by human beings. So from the software point of view, it's almost identical. The only difference we can tell on the high pitch side, but when human beings play a sound, you get, because of your skin, you damp the sound, so it doesn't ring that long. With a robot, you notice it's made out of hard plastic, there's a continuous slide ringing sound. But that is not bad. In fact, people like, you know, the song to ring, the song, like, you know, it gives a fullness to it. So we did that. But how could we implement it? Now, I know people think that art and engineering are on two different ends. That's not true. What we looked at existing technology that is used in industry, in the process plants, in manufacturing plants, etc. And we use that technology because when you look at a rhythm, what is a rhythm? A sequence of beats that are repeated continuously. When you look at industry, sequential operations are repeated continuously. So we looked at the same sort of controller there, and we applied it to the robot. So what we got was a robot that actually plays the beats, various rhythms and beats, and we'll listen to it briefly at the end. But analyzing robots, you want the human beings that are the ones who enjoy music, not machines and analysis. So we did a piece, and we tested to some students. We started this project at the University of the West Indies, and we asked a group of students, We had the piece, one, the robot was playing, the other one, a human being was playing. And we asked, could you tell the difference? Which one is the robot is playing in, and which one the human being? 75% couldn't tell the difference. We expected 100% to tell the difference. So we asked the 25%, how did you know that it was a robot playing? We found out two interesting things. Most of the 25% were actually musicians themselves. And secondly, the reason why they said is when you come back from the verse to the chorus, the human being plays faster. You know, Trinidadians like fast music and fast rhythm. So drummers get excited and they come back to the rhythm, they play faster. A robot doesn't do that. It stays one way. So that's one interesting. So we got this robot to work really well. The next thing then is that we asked the question, could such a robot be integrated into a human band? We didn't want the robot alone. So we got a small band, traditional band that is comprised of a singer who normally plays a harmonium, a tabla player, a drummer, a chorus, and a percussion instrument, a majira. We told them, look, we're going to replace the drummer with the robot. Tell us the song you're singing, tell us the beat you want, and we program it for it. We did that, and a few months ago, the band made a public performance, and the only way I can say the performance was a hit. That's the raves we got for it. So obviously, that we can integrate the robot into the band. But some interesting things emerge also, in that when you look at the robot in the band programming, the training time for the performance was reduced dramatically. The robot is not hard-headed. Once you program it, it knows what to do. Right? It's not temperamental like some drummers. So we found that it was a lot better. The practice time was reduced severely. But then the question, you know, arose that when you're making live performances, sometimes, you know, depends on the response from the audience. The singer wants to sing a bit faster. He wants a particular part emphasized. You know, so variations that emerge from emotion as such. Can the robot do that? The existing machines that are programmed cannot do that. Ours can't do it. And presently we are doing testing where we're allowing the robot to make spontaneous variations within defined parameters and judge the audience reaction, whether, you know, the clap, then we know, well, it's a good. If they don't make any sound, the robot dispenses with that. This is human beings learn. When you try something new, nobody appreciates it, you give it up. It's not so. People like it, you do it again. So then we ask ourselves the next question, a logical progression. Having produced a robot that sounds like a human being playing the drum, integrated into a band, can we produce a fully, you know, robotic band? That's the next step forward. So what we did, we had a normal robot, and by the way, his name is Tumru. So we had Tumru playing the rhythm, and then we designed a dancer whose name is Apsara. Apsara means angel. Now there are various types of Indian dances, and the one we use was what is called Bharatanatyam, very old dance. So there's a lot of head movements, a lot of movements this way, and a lot of movements this way, swinging this way. This robot, Tumru, is pretty small. The dancer was just shorter than me. My ego wouldn't allow the dancer to be taller than me. So we got the dancer just shorter than me, but life size, fully bedecked, you know, with the fancy Indian wear, shalwar, garara as it's called. And we had this dancer dance to the beat of Tumru playing the tabla. Again, she danced. And notice I said she danced with rhythm to the tabla, but because it was life size and we are on this evolutionary scale of development, when she rotated this way to swing back this way, when we go this way, we need to damp it properly before we come back this way. In human beings, when you swing this way, the muscles damp it, so there's no shaking. We found that there's some issues with damping that we are presently working on. And quite frankly, hopefully next year, by the middle of next year, we want to have a concert in which Tumru Apsara and the majira player will take part. Now, part of what we are doing also is developing a steel pan player. Now, steel pan is a curved surface, and therefore getting the notes is a lot more complex. Now, I know you see steel pan and people jump and move and stuff like that. You look at a good steel pan player, His wrist moves only his wrist. And therefore, we have finished the design of a life-size robot that plays the steel pan. We're actually doing some testing now with the software and assembling the robot. And well, this is my hope. By middle of next year also, we'll have that steel pan robot there. And in the concert, certainly next year, we'll have one with the steel pan robot playing, the tumru. I haven't given the steel pan robot a name as yet. I'll have to find one. The tumru will be playing tabla. We'll have the majira player, which we have built and already testing. And Apsara will be dancing. Now, why we want to do this? This will represent a real rainbow fusion of the cultures and peoples of Trinidad and Tobago. Steel pan, tabla, dancing. That's how we are. And the reason why we want to do that, we feel to make a statement, a technological statement, to a social problem, where we should have harmony and diversity. For too long here in Trinidad, that there are too many forces, you know, pulling us apart instead of bringing us together. We need to have some harmony. And we feel if we can show fusion, rainbow fusion, in a robot band, we think it's going to send the right message to society at large. Hey, if the robots could do it, why can't we? Now we come to the ticklish part. Can robot musicians replace human beings? Now, the robots, would you believe, Tumru looks very pleasant and nice and peaceful and non-threatening, is that so? Somebody threatened to shoot him already. This says, why are robots going to replace us? So a musician threatened to shoot him, and all like him. But this is something we have to face as we go forward in life, that robots are slowly but surely going to replace some of the functions that we do. And I want to put it in a larger context of robotics in the world. And those of you who read my column in The Guardian, my Monday's article is entitled Robots Rising. Now, you look at what's happening in the world. Technology is indispensable. There's no doubt about it. But the kind of technology we use really will be what we call dumb technology. Even the fastest computer, the supercomputer, is essentially dumb. Can do very fast calculations, but you can't think. In that regard, you know, there was this famous expert system done at Stanford University to diagnose diseases. Most doctors couldn't compete with this machine. It was a lot better than all doctors, actually, in this particular knowledge domain. But this machine that was so smart in diagnosing rare diseases couldn't tell whether a human being was alive or dead. So it comes down with this definition of artificial intelligence. What is it? Is it the ability to compute, or is it the ability to survive? And in fact, there's no definition of artificial intelligence. There's a famous question that's been asked. And I'll ask it to you. Do you think you're smarter than a cockroach? No offense intended. Because if intelligence is about surviving, cockroaches doing better than we are, yeah? So about intelligence is not really about computation, but about reacting to the environment and surviving. So this is something we have to understand. So in this larger context of artificial intelligence, a lot of the machines now are being endowed with intelligence. So machines are moving away from being our dumb servants, actually, to our partners. And this is something that mankind has to get used to, and womankind also, has to get used to. And a good example, when you look at, for instance, your parking system, you know, your collision avoidance system, you work in partnership with the sensors and the computer in the car to park your car properly. That's how it is, in partnership. The car doesn't do it for you, you don't do it for the car, you work together. And more machines are going to come that way. In fact, you look at warfare. Soldiers are increasingly using robotic devices to fight. So it has become part. So whether we like it or not, the future is this, that robots are going to take part, the technologies are there, they're being developed. It is going to happen. We're going to have this partnership with robots. So they're going to replace some human beings, but we should not see it as replacement, we should see it as a partnership with machines. They're not threatening, we don't have to worry, ask them off, they're going to kill us and take us away, etc. They will work with us, because we designed them. We're going to have some social aspects, as I said, when The factories were automated. Workers and unions behaved very badly. And I hope there are no union people here to pelt me. And we're going to face a similar thing here, that people are going to be threatened on a psychological level and on the level of jobs. But it's something going to come. So as I see the future, as I said before, it's a partnership with us and robots, intelligent machines, and it's going to, you know, that's the way forward. And we shouldn't be threatened about it. What we should do, actually, is to set the protocols in place, learn about it, and feel comfortable, because it's going to help in a strange way, actually, if we use robots properly, human evolution is going to be pushed. So if we have less men with ADD or ADHD, it may help us. If it make us better, if we have a machine competing with us, we can excel, do more. So we shouldn't see it as a threat. We should see it as an opportunity. Before I close, I'll just give a quick demonstration, very, very brief, of how it is, how it's done, and how is, you know, the robot operates actually. If my singing voice is not that pleasant, forgive me.